So this video is going to be about how I made this track. If you haven't watched it yet, I provided a link in the description. If you have, then welcome. A lot of people in the LimeWriter Discord, which is a great place for people who are interested in LimeWriter, were curious as to what techniques I used behind the scenes, which is why this video exists. There's a lot of ground to cover, but if you want the general gist, the entire process of making this track involved me pushing LimeWriter.com to its absolute limit, which I was only able to feasibly do thanks to a lot of pre-planning as well as having a good idea of what I wanted the track to be and the obstacles I'd have to overcome along the way. This greatly differs from my previous non-April Fool's release, With or Without You, I know you're not alone. A track that started with one core idea, the ending, and was built upon along the way. While that track took several months to make, gave me a myriad of technical difficulties that I did not anticipate, and was made entirely with LRA, Cradles was a tightly controlled project from beginning to end made with LimeWriter.com, an LRA user-unfriendly software that I was not familiar with at all, but nonetheless the software I had to use, because LimeWriter.com is the only LimeWriter software out there that has a layers feature. This allowed for me to put lines in an invisible layer so the track would have an overall clean array aesthetic and not be cluttered with lines that the main writer would never interact with. It's a feature that I used throughout the entire track, meaning that I had to use LimeWriter.com if I wanted this track to come out the way I wanted it to come out. But that begs the question, how'd I even come up with this concept for a track in the first place? Short answer, it just came to me. I was listening to the song, thinking of LimeWriter at the moment, wondered how I could sync the song to a LimeWriter track, came up with one dope concept after the other, and little by little, everything fell into place. But if you want the long answer that digs more into what might have been my subconscious process at that moment, I direct you to these five tracks. Omniverse 2, OK, The Marriage of Figaro, So You Think You Know Curves, and Neon Rider. Let's start with Omniverse 2, since that's the simplest one to explain. Omniverse 2 was what first got me into the idea of story-based LimeWriter tracks. That said, I generally don't approach LimeWriter as an art medium because I usually find it to be very limiting as one, especially when compared to other art mediums like animation. There's a reason why a vast majority of story-based LimeWriter tracks involve a point A to point B plot. Bosch is in the Omniverse, he has to get out of the Omniverse. Bosch is in a desolate area, he has to go where the grass is green. Bosch is old, he's going to the forest under the earth to die. Point A, point B, point A, point B, and when it comes to the few story-based LimeWriter tracks that don't follow this archetype, their story is often hidden behind subtext or ambiguity. You'd have to really pay attention to grasp the story of a track like Hostile Arrays or Eden 2. These type of tracks also have the tendency to use music or titles as a means of conveying the story across, or they'll have the story take a backseat to the emotions being conveyed, like Falling in Love, Picnic, or Nightmare. This is not a knock on any of these tracks for the record, I love pretty much all of them. Plus, point A to point B is a trope that can be easily subverted. In some tracks, Bosch won't even make it to point B, he'll remain stuck in point A like in Delirium or Omniverse, and there are tracks like Beethoven's Fifth that do actually tell a more complex story that the viewer can easily understand, as well as more experimental tracks like the St. Patrick Battalion and Freaks. However, what I am saying is that there's not a lot you can reasonably do with LimeWriter from a storytelling perspective. At least, that's what I thought. What made Omniverse 2 captivating for me was its execution and the techniques it used, and I'm not just talking about the quirk, I'm talking about the camera, the artistry, the workarounds Conundrumer used to create 3D shapes for the ending. It also was one of, if not the first LimeWriter track to offer a direct story and have that story lead way to subtext, instead of the story being disguised by subtext or being straightforward altogether. These ideas had so much potential for future tracks, but I didn't want to really follow up on any of them until I had a clear vision that I wanted to see through. That leads us to OK, which provided the basis for this track. Unlike Omniverse 2, OK is a simple and repetitive yet charming track that utilizes the 10-point canon in unconventional ways. I wanted to have that same repetitive nature for this remounting idea I had in my head for the song. For a while, I just wanted to build upon this one concept like I do with most other tracks of mine. I had the intro and the chorus, I just needed to figure out how to expand upon both of them for the rest of the song. Then, as I listened more to the song, an idea came to my head. What if Bosch is in possession of all these sleds because he's a serial killer who kills other writers for their sleds? Then I thought about how certain lyrics could be recontextualized into the most meta shit ever. I live inside my own world of make-believe. And that's when I was like, oh hell yeah, I'm doing this. This is when The Marriage of Figaro came into play. The Marriage of Figaro provided a good blueprint as to how I could go about visualizing Bosch killing another writer. However, I didn't want Bosch to drop down from a higher place and crush another rider like The Marriage of Figaro. I wanted him to come from behind and then kill his victim, the same way real serial killers do. I ended up achieving this effect by using multi-line techniques that initiated from So You Think You Know Curves. The general idea of that track was having Bosch recycle through uncompromising curves in impossible ways through the use of tiny, hidden multi-lines that would manipulate Bosch's speed and movement. While my track doesn't contain recycling in any conventional ways, it does contain recycling in that multiple riders would often be on the same line, traveling at different speeds. Through the use of multi-lines, I could get Bosch to slow down and speed up at dramatic points in the song without affecting the other rider. The final track I want to talk about is Neon Rider. Neon Rider is most notable for taking post-production to an extreme that makes it debatable as to whether or not it's even a track. It's not the first track to do this for the record, but it's certainly the one that popularized the concept of an anti-track or non-track, whatever you want to call it. Now, Neon Rider is a great and interesting watch, but outside of other tracks like Dangerous Cargo and Echo Jam's A1, it hasn't really been expanded upon that much, which I find to be a shame because utilizing post-production to the levels I did for this Line Rider track elevated it to a whole nother level. Adding a static filter that would recur throughout the track, having a camera pan into a static shot through editing by splicing two video clips together, crossfading the perspectives of two different riders, cuts to other riders, these were all things that I wanted to add to the track as soon as I conceptualized it, and I think a lot more could be done with non-tracks than what I presented here. More track makers should seriously try it out. Before I could even begin working on the track, I had to edit the original audio so that whenever there was a part of a track that I wanted to be slowed down or sped up in editing, I could adjust the sync accordingly. I actually had to make two separate audio files. The first is the regular audio, but without the second half of the second verse and the second chorus. I cut those parts out because I had no ideas for them and I didn't want to drag out the track longer than necessary. In hindsight, I could have tried to do something with those parts since the final result might be a bit too fast-paced for some viewers, but you live and you learn. The second audio file is the first audio file, but with varying speeds throughout. It's what I heard while making the track. It sounds like this. Hear the children sing aloud. Yeah. I put both of these audio files in Sony Vegas, took the original track, and split the parts that would have their speeds changed from the normal speed parts. This isn't my first time messing with speed in a Line Rider track, but it is the first time I had to mess with it throughout the entirety of one, both in the track and in editing. I often had to go back into Audacity and make adjustments to the edited audio file because I ran into a complication within the track or I wanted to change the length of a certain slowed down segment. A great example of this is the remount section. In LineRider.com, there's a 30 frame delay between when the rider dies and when he can remount back onto his sled. Usually, this isn't a problem, unless you want Bosch to jump from sled to sled at an extremely high rate. In which case, it's very much a problem. I had the music play normally at this part initially, but after seeing how many frames passed between each beat, I had to slow the music down. Eventually, I slowed it down 50% and that allowed for a nice 30 frame gap between each beat. This might have been a tedious process in any other situation, but considering LineRider.com is an intimidating software for LRA users, I was more than happy to get away from it whenever I could. So, I wanted all the sleds to be standing up with Bosch lying down. Here's how I did it. Needless to say, it was pretty difficult to get the sleds in that position and have them appear on screen in sync with the audio. This part was mainly trial by error. However, and I do this with pretty much all my tracks because they all involve manipulation of the camera in some way, I kept note to myself what the starting zoom of this track was, which was 1.925 or 2.025 for exporting purposes. This helped, but it was still mainly trial by error. A similar thing can be said for how I was able to get the sled and the rider to remount during that one crucial scene. And as far as to how I was able to get all those sleds in place, yeah, there's not much to say about the first part of the track other than that it was a bitch to do and I had to be aware of LimeRider.com's more hidden features, like how to add more than three riders. There is a catch though, and one that I expected. Lag. Lots and lots of lag. Doing this remounting section was already hard enough, but what made it even harder was LineRider.com running at 1 frame per second whenever I adjusted the lines. Not only did I have to deal with lag, I also had to make sure the riders that I killed in the beginning didn't suddenly appear in view of the track because they interacted with any of these track lines. Needless to say, the track file was a mess, which is why, after I finished the first third of the track, I created a whole new track file. Though, I didn't want viewers to get the impression that we switched to another track entirely after the static in the video, so I copy and pasted this whole section into the second track file, made this part green lines, and started the track file with long-ass lines for all five riders, letting the audio play out until it got to the appropriate parts for each rider respectively. In hindsight, if I never did this, I probably wouldn't have been able to finish the track. As far as the rest of the track goes, it was considerably much easier to do than the first third. The first third alone took me a week to make, and the rest of the track, which counted for two thirds, took me the same amount of time. I didn't have to do anything too crazy other than the techniques that I've already explained. The biggest challenge I had to face was just getting used to LineRider.com, learning more of its features along the way, like how to use the camera zoom and panning tools, which are actually fairly simple to learn if you have a basic understanding of JavaScript code. Though the camera tool doesn't have an option that allows for it to stop at a static shot, so I had to pan the camera in just the right way for this one part, and even then I had to crop the static shot a little in Sony Vegas so that it meshed well with the panning shot. Now, I didn't use every tool. I heard there's a shading tool that's available on LineRider.com. I didn't know how to access that, but I didn't need it for this track anyways. However, all the tools I've been using up until this point, remounting, multiple riders, layers, multi-lines, camera zoom, and camera panning, are all pretty new to LineRider in the grand scheme of things, and it got to the point where I don't think I would have been able to conceptualize this track even a year ago. And that's what was so exciting about working on this track. I remember when multiple riders and remounting got introduced, and a lot of people in the LineRider community thought these features were gimmicky, or they didn't know what to think about them. There were still some cool ideas presented with these features, like a potential new style of quirk with remounting, but overall, we don't see a lot of tracks with multiple riders, and we definitely don't see a lot of tracks with remounting, and when we do, they tend to just be elements that are there. Making these elements a vital part of a LineRider track is rare, but once I did that, it got me to rethink LineRider as a whole. I started thinking, wow, LineRider could actually be an entirely new art medium in the making. It was overwhelming, to be honest, but this feeling made me want to finish the track. Ever since Omniverse 2 came out, people have been wondering how to follow up on it, and I felt like I had the answer. I felt like I owed it to the community to make this track. And so I did. P.S. This sixth one right here? Fuck this one. All of these were pretty hard to do, but this one in particular made me go insane. I had to export 8 different videos for this track. The first video was the first third of a track in 40 frames per second, the second video was the first third of a track in 60 frames per second, the third video was the first cut to Blue's perspective, the fourth video was the static shot, the fifth video was Red's perspective from here to here, the sixth video was Blue's perspective from here until the end, the seventh video was Red falling down the first 7 lines, and the last video was Red falling down the rest of the lines and the ending. And this does not count the videos I didn't use because they weren't of the right quality or didn't mesh well with other videos that might have needed to mesh with in the editor. Overall, I exported 14 different videos for this track. And I also had to convert all these videos to MP4 since LineRider.com only exports videos in WebM and I can't put WebM files in Sony Vegas. That's not the kicker. The kicker is, ideally, I only wanted to export 6 videos, but I had to export 8 because by the time I finished the last 2/3 of a track, I had a track file with a shit ton of multi-lines and 19 riders. This differs from the first third of the track because although that had 18 riders, it also didn't have any multi-lines and didn't contain as much data, so I was able to record that track file well enough. This track file, on the other hand, would constantly crash my browser if I even tried to play the track from beginning to end, and worst part, the video exporter wouldn't even show anything. Like, it straight up wasn't working. Therefore, in order to circumvent this issue, I had to go into the JSON file itself, determine which riders were represented by their coordinates, remove any unnecessary riders for a portion of the track, save the changes into another file, and export the appropriate portion of the track through said file. This would get tricky because, if you've ever opened the JSON file in Notepad before, you'll notice how it's kind of a big wall of code. I basically had to do this. This way my eyes wouldn't strain themselves looking at the shit, and even then there were still times where I fudged up the coding, leading me to delete the track file and make another one. In the end, I had 5 different track files. This is what I meant when I said I pushed LineWriter.com to its absolute limit, and that if I didn't separate the track files like I did, I would have never been able to finish this track. I pretty much broke LineWriter. Finally, we get to the editing process. Like I said, I made this track and edited it simultaneously, but even with that, I still had some complications. The biggest one would have to be the chroma keying. See, I wanted all of the victims of our main character to have a brown-colored scarf, and the boss that kills our main character but is also a serial killer to have a blue-colored scarf. And if you want to know why, subtext. I wanted to experiment with subtext after viewing Omniverse 2 because Omniverse 2's subtext revolved entirely around LimeWriter. I asked myself, what if I could add subtext that has nothing to do with LimeWriter? And so, the subtext in this track, if it wasn't obvious enough from the colors I described, is racism. On the surface, this is a track about Bosch being a serial killer who murders other innocent writers for their sleds, only to get stopped by another Bosch who just wants to remove the competition for the exact same goal. If you look deeper, however, Bosch is now a racist mass shooter who kills other writers for the color of their scarves. And the blue Bosch, who's supposed to stop people like this, well, they do, but they end up doing the exact same thing at times, just in a much more sneaky and manipulative manner. The ultimate irony is how much we take from black culture, and yet, this is a treatment and or fears that black people have to face in this country. Also, I wrote the script months ago, and since then, this message ended up being more relevant than ever. I guess one could consider this track to be a protest track in the same vein as Hard Times or Level of Concern, but those tracks have their messages more at the forefront. This one's more in the background. I had the idea for this subtext pretty early on in the track-making process, and I was able to account for some things as a result. For example, I knew green would be the easiest color to chroma key in and wouldn't get in the way of the red scarf, so I made sure all of Bosch's victims had a green scarf. This meant having to go through the color cycle multiple times with up to 10 writers. This also meant, before exporting the track, I couldn't just remove all the unnecessary writers in the coding. I had to go through 3 color cycles and then remove the rest. This doesn't mean, however, that all of these writers are green. For this part, I just had to put in extra effort when it came to masking and chroma keying. But it was helpful to do little things here and there that actually made this process possible in the first place. Funny too, because I actually didn't consider the scarf colors a vital part of the track until a couple days before the track's release. I don't really want to talk about what happened since it's a very personal story, but basically, something that happened to me IRL forced me to consider this subtext a vital part of my track. If nothing else, out of my own frustration with explaining fucking racism to people who are accidentally racist. That's all you need to know. Anyways, here's the trouble I ran into while editing. Towards the end, there's a segment where the blue writer and the brown writer are together. This is the first time the blue writer is seen on a screen with a brown writer. I did not anticipate that a bit of the blue writer's blueness would be chroma keyed out with the green. Now, the blue scarf wasn't completely transparent, fortunately, but it was a darker shade than the shade shown on LineWriter.com. I tried working around this, but I couldn't. I tried messing around with other Sony Vegas features that had to do with coloring to no avail. I couldn't mask the blue writer and the brown writer in 2 separate video clips since they interact with each other at this point and at the stall. And I couldn't change the color of the scarf because every other color, blue, red, and rainbow, took 2 to 4 chroma keys to make fully transparent, all of which involving the color blue. The worst part is that I realized this towards the end of the editing process, after chroma keying the rest of the video to account for the blue writer. Therefore, I had to remove a lot of the chroma keying to keep the blue at a darker shade so that it'd be consistent throughout the entire track. This is not the only stupid thing I had to deal with. Did you know that if you add a noise effect before adding a chroma key effect, the chroma keying will interfere with the noise effect, but if you add a noise effect after adding a chroma key effect, the noise effect will remain intact? I don't know why. And of course, if this track-making process wasn't long and complicated enough, I had to render this video, like, 3 times because of little nooks and crannies I had to fix. Mostly it was the noise effect not showing as much noise as I wanted it to in crucial moments. Not to mention, editing this track would seriously do a number on my computer CPU. I don't know why. I think that's just a problem with my computer for some reason, but Sony Vegas did not agree with what I was feeding it. It crashed on multiple occasions. But eventually, I got a final product that I was satisfied with, and from there, it was a matter of uploading the video and making the thumbnail, which I drew in Toon Boom Studio 8.1. Took like 15 minutes to draw. I figured it would spice up a track I was already especially proud of, and that was about the end of it. In conclusion, is this track perfect? No. The green screen fire at the end might come across as cheesy to some, but colors could have been better accentuated by not being as dark as they were, though I couldn't really do much about that. And maybe I could have added extra content, like scenery, that would give way to lore, and I didn't expand upon everything that Omniverse 2 had to offer. Also, as mentioned earlier, it might be too fast-paced for some viewers. But, with all that said, I'm still very proud of the final result. I made Cradles in an attempt to challenge what a track could be, even going as far as to deceptively make it look like a regular track, and by all accounts, I consider the track a success. As I'm making this video, I'm already seeing the Line Rider community take notes. Rabbit Squirrel just released his amazing new track, New Normal. Yeah, you could tell this video was in development for a while. That follows up on a lot of the concepts Cradles presented. And if you ask me, I think it might be better than Cradles, but that's not a knock on my track whatsoever. Cradles, in my eyes, is a blueprint. To what, that's for the community and myself to decide, but as of now, given the reception it's received and the effect it's been having already, I couldn't ask for anything more. Now, as far as this video goes, I hope people get something out of it. I hope it inspires people. I hope I can make more tracks like Cradles in the future. I hope I see more tracks with their own ideas and their own unique spin on previous ideas. But most importantly, I hope people have more of an understanding and appreciation of how I or other people approach Line Rider. We're all valid at the end of the day. Quirker, artist, conceptualizer, physics simulator, multimedia project, lectures, political activism, you name it. There's no wrong way to approach Line Rider. You can make a bad product, sure, but don't let that turn you off from embracing new ideas or different mindsets. I think everyone can benefit from trying something new. I mean, who knows? You might just surprise yourself. Special thanks to the Line Rider community for helping me navigate LineRider.com, Sheldon for being on call that one night I was going insane working on the track, Rabbit Squirrel for their support, Conundrumer for existing, and you for watching. I hope this video was enjoyable, and I will see you in the next project that I do. Whenever that will be.